So what is FastHTML, the new kid on the web development block? We'll look at its strengths in terms of simplicity and Python integration, as well as its limitations. By the end, you'll know if FastHTML is worth your time, or if you should stick with more established tools. So what's the big deal with FastHTML? Well, in short, it allows you to build web apps using Python instead of JavaScript. For anyone who's a fan of Python or who's allergic to JavaScript's quirks, that might sound very tempting. But can FastHTML really stand up to React, to Next.js, and to the other big players? Is it a viable alternative, or just a passing fad? Well, let's dig in and see what FastHTML is all about, its strengths, its weaknesses, and if it is for you. First, its strengths. Let's start by looking at one of FastHTML's most impressive features, its scalability. As the website states, FastHTML's goal is to be the easiest way to create quick prototypes, and also the easiest way to create scalable, powerful, rich applications. Why these two extremes? Well, because the best way to create a big, complex application is first to create a small, simple application and then add to it in small steps. If we don't make it easier to create small, simple applications, then fewer people get started and fewer ideas get tried. Now, I like that mindset, but how does FastHTML achieve this? And does it hold up to its promises? Well, here's the reactive Hello World app. And as you can see, you can create a minimalistic full stack web application with just 6 lines of Python code. So it can certainly scale down. But how does it scale up? Well, simplicity doesn't necessarily mean sacrificing power. Behind the scenes, FastHTML uses HTMX and ASGI to connect the dots between the different parts of a web application. And let's take a closer look. As you probably know, HTMX is a popular lightweight JavaScript library that extends HTML syntax. It allows you to declare within the HTML how your interface will interact with the backend API. The hxget equals slash change code does precisely this. It produces a div that will call the change route when it's clicked. ASGI now connects HTTP routes with Python functions. That's what the @rt/change notation does. It defines the Python function that is to be called when that route is called. This setup is very much HTMX's primary use case. The examples in the launch video include the now obligatory to-do app, including drag and drop and markdown rendering, and a version of Conway's Game of Life, both with only a few lines of Python application code. Now, there's no getting around the fact that browsers speak JavaScript, not Python. But co-opting HTMX and ASGI allows FastHTML to enable Python programmers to build fully-fledged web apps without writing any JavaScript. There is JavaScript running, mind you, it's just not visible from the application code. An example of this is how markdown rendering is implemented. FastHTML uses the library called 0MD, which searches through the DOM for any tags with that name, and then it converts their contents from markdown to HTML. Like HTMX, 0MD is written in JavaScript, but it's hidden behind the scenes. You don't need to know any JavaScript to use it. And this ties in to another of FastHTML strengths, its Pythonic approach. If you're already comfortable with Python, you'll feel right at home. There's no need to learn new templating languages. It'll still wrap your head around JavaScript frameworks. This familiarity doesn't just make development faster, it also enhances code readability and maintainability. Now, a bonus advantage of this, given that running a FastHTML app is nothing more than executing a Python program, FastHTML deployment is very easy. You can easily deploy to Railway and Vercel and even Hugging Face, or if you need to scale up to any fully fledged Python server. But perhaps the most important strength is how fast you can get going. The framework creators state that we've heard from expert coders that they've successfully built complete web apps within an hour of getting started with FastHTML. That's a bold claim, but it speaks to FastHTML's single context, Python, and its ease of use. If you're already familiar with Python, you can be up and running with FastHTML faster than you can say hello world. However, FastHTML also has some downsides and limitations. First, FastHTML is in its early stages. It's not as battle-tested as React or Next.js or Angular. While this is exciting for early adopters, it also comes with risks, such as unexpected bugs or limitations. I also found the markup declaration syntax a bit clunky. I'm used to JSX and to Angular's templates or even to Twig templates. In terms of where the rendering code is located, this is perhaps closest to JSX, but for the moment it doesn't feel fluid, it doesn't feel natural. The community support and the ecosystem around FastHTML are also very young. If you're used to the vast arrays of libraries and tools and tutorials and resources that are available for established frameworks, you might find the FastHTML landscape a bit sparse. If you need a specific UI component or integration, you might have to build it yourself or wait for the community to catch up. When it comes to large-scale production applications, FastHTML, I think, still has some way to go. In fact, for now, I wouldn't even use it for my blog. Why? Well, because handling Markdown in JavaScript means content rendering is happening on the client side only, which is subpar in terms both of SEO and user experience. And although FastHTML's application code is in Python, its use of HTMX to provide client-side interactivity means you'll need to understand and learn how HTMX works to effectively use FastHTML. It's not just Python. There is another layer to learn and understand. So what does this mean for web development? And what does it mean for you as a developer or future developer? In the Python web development world, Django and Flask are the go-to choices for Python developers, and they have been for years. They're robust, they're well-documented, they have large communities. But while Django and Flask focus on server-side rendering, FastHTML bridges the gap between server and client. It offers a more integrated solution similar to what Streamlit is offering, although Streamlit is focused on a more specific data wrangling use case. So is FastHTML worth your time? Well, it depends on who you are and what you're looking for. First off, FastHTML is geared to Python developers. Don't bother if you've majored in JavaScript. There are other more suitable options. Second, FastHTML isn't set to become the next big thing just yet. It could be a great starting point to start learning web concepts. It shows how HTMX can be useful for backend frameworks. It does offer a fresh perspective. For the moment, it's more suited for prototypes or for small projects where rapid development is key. Ultimately, FastHTML's value lies in its potential. It's hard to predict FastHTML's long-term viability. It won't be a React or Next.js killer, but it shows how Python frameworks can create web apps with rich client-side interactivity by leveraging HTMX. Which means that the next step, whether you want to adopt FastHTML or just be inspired by its interactivity, is to understand HTMX. Thankfully, I've got you covered. I'll see you in the next video.